Your Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, it's indeed my privilege and an honor to be here amongst you and to participate in this conclave. I congratulate India Today for creating this platform and the opportunity to hear some of the great leaders, achievers, authorities, and authorities of international repute. I do realize, however, this post-lunch session can be a bit difficult on the listeners. This could well be to my advantage at the discussion that may follow. The topic I've been asked to explore is on future fires. Fires I define as aggression on the state that threatens peace and stability when military action is seen as the only answer. Such fires could and must be prevented, and if they do occur, these must be fought with full might, heart, and soul. The very first question that comes to my mind is that of our vulnerability. How vulnerable are we? How vulnerable is India? Vulnerability, gentlemen, often tempts aggression. A multitude of pressures has cropped upon nations over the last decade or so. Migration of population, narco-terrorism, religious persecutions, regime changes, political instabilities, economic crisis, and many more. To my mind, the foremost in our context are three. The pressure of population, limitation of resources, and governance. It is quite staggering how the population of our country has grown since independence. We were around 340 million the year we became independent. By 1980, the population had doubled and then tripled by the year 2000. We are currently adding one child every 2 seconds or less. 58% of our population is in the working age group. Yesterday we heard that this also has a flip side. Potentially a large working population is an advantage provided that they are employed usefully and productively. Research indicates that the world's human population already has exceeded what the world's natural resources could support without serious depletion. The sum total of energy of our planet, dear friends, is a fixed quantity fixed by the Almighty on the day of creation. Following the law of entropy, energy is constantly being converted from usable to unusable and is irreplaceable. Coal, for example, is turned into ash and heat. The heat dissipates and is irrecoverable. We import petroleum, oil, and lubricants in a big way that swallows up 78% of our export earnings, which is sizable indeed. Similar is the situation with respect to water and food. It could get only worse as the years go by. Population gets restless and impatient when threatened by shortages. It is predicted that the future wars could well be about water and energy. To sum up, we are extremely vulnerable. Resources are meager to meet the aspirations of a sizable population that is able-bodied but without sufficient earning power or work. As the pressure increases, social and political explosions are likely. Disease attacks a weak body. When our nation is vulnerable, we are susceptible to exploitation from outside and social unrest from within. We have seen that our not-too-friendly neighbor never hesitated to exploit incidents of our internal strife to weaken us. It is well recognized that economic strength is vital to a nation's security. China, we discussed yesterday, is an example where the entire nation has a single focus on industrialization and economic development. They have been at it for the last two decades. If ever we want to get abreast with China, say by year 2020, our economy needs to grow at an impossible rate of about 12% per annum. Even 2050 appears improbable, since it calls for a steady growth at an average rate of around 9% per annum. India, where it is today, is by choice. We cannot blame it on anyone but ourselves. We need to evolve a national strategy and focus our resources and energy on selected core areas in the field of science, technology, development, and production. Is it too late? Have we given up? Not really so. We have had pleasant surprises, such as the IT sector. There are other promising areas. An example, I must say, is the field of aeronautics, which I know personally is ready to take off. Unfortunately, it is in the public sector and most constrained. We have brilliant people ready and willing to work hard. All that we need is quality governance, quality decisions in time, and minimal bureaucracy. Rhetoric will not help. Firm actions on ground are the need of the hour. With all its disadvantages, you know very well that India has many achievements to its credit. Some may call it a miracle. In the years since independence, we have grown to be responsible and a mature democracy. The growth was not easy, but rough and lonely. Winston Churchill declared in 1935 at the debate on India Bill, he said, to quote, "In handing over the government of India to these so-called political classes," he protested, "we are handing over to men of straw, of whom in a few years no trace will remain." How wrong Winston Churchill was. Our leaders proved to be stronger than steel. For the initial 30 years or so, which I would term as the Nehruvian era, our policies were based on idealism. Since then, idealism has gradually been shifting towards national interests. We still see much evidence of stubborn idealism, which at times work against our national interest. Each party and each leader has different ideas and ideals. I guess that is what democracy is all about. We keep our fingers crossed. It is vital that the issues are debated, as other democracies do, on the floor of the parliament. At the national level, there ought to be a wider understanding of how nations operate in their self-interest, and debate over where our own interests lie. Traditionally, we've been reactive, but never proactive. There may be some truth in what George Tanham wrote about Indian thoughts on strategy. He states that India does not have a tradition of strategic thoughts or even strategic culture. This is ascribed to India not being sovereign for most part of its history. Before the British came to India, thoughts of various rulers on security were about their respective positions and challenges within, but they rarely thought of security of the state as such. We may still be continuing along our traditional thoughts unwittingly. Is that one of the reasons why we have so much of infighting in our society? Certainly a point to ponder. Recently, the British Prime Minister called for changes in international law to allow preemptive military action against countries suspected of human rights violations or seen as a threat to others. He sought to rewrite the centuries-old rule that barred interference in other countries' internal affairs. A year ago, such an approach was unthinkable. One probable reason for the suggestion to come up is that today, preemption is feasible. USA, supported by its allies, has demonstrated their capability to launch a preemptive action. Under these circumstances, it makes me wonder, how credible could nuclear deterrence be in the Indian subcontinent, with a superpower having the capability to preempt and watch over constantly? Pakistan has declared that it would use the nuclear weapon first if it needs to. Can the Shaheen missile be launched in a surprise attack without detecting the preparation? Would it be stopped? Besides us, who else would be interested to stop it, and why? The whole gamut of nuclear deterrence takes a complex dimension when countries that are not in league with the superpowers play the new game of nuclear deterrence. If we go as per the recent articulation by the British Prime Minister, the declared first use of nuclear weapon by Pakistan is certainly a threat to others, and it would certainly be a human right violation when a large population being threatened to extinction. Over the last 15 years or more, we've been fighting a war on terrorism. We have been losing soldiers and citizens practically every day since the war started. Our adversary bled us, but could not beat us. Unfortunately, till 9/11, the world did not show much concern to our predicament. It was amazing how the world has changed since 9/11. If the tragedy had not occurred on that fateful day, Pakistani terror outfits Harkal Mujahideen, Lashkar-e-Toyba, and Jaish-e-Mohammed would not have been banned, or for that matter, Pakistan would not have been asked to stop cross-border terrorism. The secrets of nuclear proliferation from Pakistan would have stayed buried. We learn that in 1971, way back, USA did not condemn the atrocity committed by East Pakistan because Pakistan was helping Henry Kissinger his historical visit to China. Not too long ago, Taliban was encouraged and armed to fight the Soviets by those who are now hunting them. I suppose all such decisions and actions had to do with national interest. It is our national interest to combat and prevent terrorism in all forms. Anti-national elements get stronger if and when governance falters. Military is often employed as an interim solution to maintain law and order and to help governance, which in the long run could be detrimental. Terrorism in India is not a conflict of ideology or uprising. It is an organized extortion today, exploitation, and a crime. Accordingly, we must handle this most firmly. 9/11 has brought the mightiest of the forces in the world to join against one of the most impoverished nations, Afghanistan. It illustrates the fact that a nation's security is to do with its vulnerability and its geographical importance. Afghanistan was used as a launch pad to fight the Soviets, and subsequently, bombs rained over Afghan soil. It was targeted by those very same powers that had befriended them. What a tragedy. Iraq was systematically isolated for years, during which the United States Air Force enforced a no-fly zone over the country. The Air Force flew over 300,000 missions well before Iraq war started the Iraqi freedom. 300,000 hours over Iraq. There are other countries in the world that face isolation. India, as a sizable power in the region, must remain strong and resolute under any kind of pressure. It is our destiny to play our role as a mature democracy and be a symbol of peace, stability, and a guide. In the recent Operation Iraqi Freedom, it is my belief that the US wanted to avoid a long-drawn campaign and serious damage to property and lives. Technology was employed most intelligently in launching a speedy surgical operation with minimum casualties to own forces and minimal collateral damage, as we heard Raj a little while ago. Skills and courage of the US Special Forces were most commendable. They operated behind the enemy lines for a considerable period, softening targets and providing vital intelligence information. Weapons with extraordinary precisions were employed. Air power was directed against the enemy's strategy, targeting enemy's pillars of power. The US demonstrated the ability to strike precisely from air in less than 40 minutes of occurrence of an event. And that is the most remarkable thing today. From an event occurs in 40 minutes, the target is being struck. What you call today is the shot sensor to shooter. You sense and you shoot in less than an hour, 40 minutes. The ground forces of the US and the coalition forces moved in consonance with air in a very well orchestrated manner. It is interesting to note that the age-old term air superiority that we talk about in India was coined in the Second World War. This has been replaced by air dominance in the lexicon of US military. The United States Air Force today is addressed as expeditionary aerospace power. The term dominance and expeditionary well reflects the objectives of the United States Air Force, the largest and the most powerful air force in the world today. Not just technology or resources alone, but vision and perseverance were needed to achieve such outstanding capabilities. In our context, we shall have to work quite hard to achieve air superiority, and maybe in certain areas, we would be satisfied to obtain limited air superiority. We are required to fight harder, get braver, and be ready to pay greater sacrifices. What is praiseworthy is the coordination of the US military and the government machinery in analyzing the performance of the Desert Storm that was fought 12 years before the Iraqi freedom. This was done speedily and intensely. Based on the analysis, resources were allocated to make significant improvements to the inventory and training methods. The improved outfits were tested within a few years and made ready to take on the fresh challenge in Iraq. sincerity of purpose and involvement of the American military, the bureaucracy, the R&D, and the industries is praiseworthy for their performance as one single team. We can learn a lot from that example. India doesn't possess any high technology of that order or the resources. We need to focus on teamwork and jointness to analyze meticulously and apply our lessons quite earnestly. Coordinated effort is necessary to focus resources and build an effective machinery within a specific time. We seldom introspect as to how difficult and time-consuming it is to equip, to train, and prepare forces for operations and to maintain them at the level of efficiency desired. It is my belief that India has no global commitment or a need for force projection. However, as the economy grows stronger, so would grow our military capability. We need to strengthen jointness, not just among the three services, but the bureaucracy must integrate and share this responsibility. The geographical extent of our national security environment extends from the Persian Gulf to the Straits of Malacca across the Indian Ocean, including Central Asia and Afghanistan in the northwest, China in the northeast, and Southeast Asia. Our strategic thinking has extended to these horizons. Our foreign minister has given a more definitive term to our interests in this expanded environment, terming it as our extended neighborhood. We as a nation would need to come out of our shell and contribute to peace and prosperity of our extended neighborhood. We should also be ready to share some of the burdens and concerns of this region. The future fire may initiate and spread to India from anywhere within the region of our security environment. Our major concern is the neighborhood. Pakistan's objective has been to weaken India and to balkanize it. After the 1971 war, vengeance fuels them, and a strategy was adapted to bleed India. Pakistan has perfected an efficient, well-oiled machinery that recruits even children to fight jihad against India. The machinery is financed and nurtured effectively. Unfortunately for them, 9/11 slowed down this machinery considerably. World opinion demanded dismantling of this jihad machinery. I do not believe personally that it is easy to do so. There is a design deficiency here. There is no button or a means to switch off or stop this machinery. It would stop only when the fuel runs out. I am quite convinced that Pakistan could go back to its traditional objective. Terrorists are active as ever in Kashmir Valley. We all hope that the peace process that has been initiated would progress. We, in the meantime, stay focused in defending our people and our territory. Speed and firmness are essential in dealing effectively against the adversarial elements. The innocents should not suffer. China, having made tremendous progress economically, is now focusing on its military. China has recently announced hiking the defense budget by a whopping 11%. Their focus now is on the high tech. Their defense outlay is about 7% of the GDP. The expenditure, it is stated, is to guarantee national security. Despite this sizable nuclear arsenal, you may wish to note their focus of China is towards achieving a balanced conventional operational capability. Modernization of Air Force and Navy are its current primary objective. Tibet has transformed in a big way. Logistics has improved tremendously in that region, So is their ability to mount air operations from Tibet. China's influence has spread systematically around our neighborhood. I sense the strategy of China is to encompass and contain India through its influence politically, militarily, and commercially. Ambassador Wisner sees USA having a stake in transformed relations with India. In broader Asian context, in his view, cooperative security ties with the United States would serve the Indian interests as a hedge, were China to become an aggressive threat. We need to research on the subject and pay more attention to understanding USA as a single superpower. Whether we like it or not, on date, it is the single pervasive global power which has taken on quite a burden on its shoulders. Stating our national priority to be development, the government is often questioned about the wisdom of spending our resources on defense. We chanted Hindi Chini Bhai Bhai, soon after which we faced the debacle. Kargil came out of the blue, following the Lahore initiative, the bus trail for peace. We can't shut our eyes and ears to some of our neighbors theorizing to murder with a borrowed knife or to fight a thousand-year war on vengeance. We need to face and counter the adversaries. Looking back in history helps. Harmless traders exploited us and subjugated our country. Raiders and looters exploited us for centuries, reducing India from one among the richest to rubble. It is imperative that we want peace. If we want peace and development, we need to spend on security. If one is poor, he could possibly afford to keep his doors open. We have a billion aspirants to get rich. As a nation, we face grave responsibilities. Management of the military, and more importantly, to employ the military where and when required, is something that our democracy is still learning. It is not adequate to have an efficient military that is only halfway. The country must have the will to use it. To have the will and confidence to use the military and correctly, the policy and decision makers must know it well enough in terms of its characteristics, capabilities, and limitations. They must participate actively in planning and training process, which would give them the opportunity to observe and to learn. They need to know broadly the methods of warfare. They should be familiar with military history, at least our own. It is debated and written about extensively on the debacle of 1962. One glaring folly was not using the Air Force to attack the invading Chinese. Academicians believe that it was fear that restricted the use of the Air Force, the fear that use of air arm would lead to escalation and Delhi will be bombed. If that was true, I believe that it was extremely unfortunate and sad. If that was true, it was lack of knowledge that prevented timely use of air power. What is the point in having a force if you do not have the will and knowledge to use it effectively? Honorable Minister Shri Jaswant Singh comments in his well-researched book that the Indian Air Force, right from its birth, was restricted by our British masters on the quality of its inventory and its operational roles, well knowing the potential of the air arm. The minister believes that it is a miracle that a large section of the Indian Air Force leadership even thought about or actually believed in an independent and strategic role for independent India's air power. Well, the miracle happened. But it is not adequate that this thought and belief are restricted to the leadership of the Air Force. Spreading it is a must for our nation's well-being. Innumerable examples are available in the recent military operations and wars for us to learn from. The Vietnam War, the Arab-Israeli Wars, the Kosovo War, the Desert Storm, and the most recent Iraqi Freedom, and so on. Far too glaring is what air power can and cannot achieve. Dominance in the air creates tremendous opportunities to apply military power effectively against the adversary. Attack from air could be very demoralizing. It is important that, to be effective, we must employ the full potential of the weapon system with full freedom of action. The military has its share of bureaucracy. I strongly believe that the military and the government machinery must learn from the private sector and apply these effectively. The areas of interest could be productivity, output, contracting, operating costs, human resource development, corporate planning, personal planning, finance and control, and so on. Accountability should be defined and enforced. It is interesting to note that China is cutting down the strength of military manpower quite significantly. Manpower costs a great deal, and it is a difficult resource to manage. The tail in our military tends to be long relative to the teeth. We need to make a conscientious attempt to improve teeth-to-tail ratio and infuse a strong machinery to control expenditure. The composition of Indian armed forces must be such that it could be employed in a strategic battle or to tackle bushfires. Internal security at times has a cross-border dimension. At times, operations in the neighborhood tend to spill over to our country. A friendly neighbor may call for our military's assistance. Our assistance may be sought to combat narcotic or cross-border smuggling. The military is an important element of our disaster relief measures. The Indian Air Force was called upon at a short notice to evacuate our citizens from Kuwait when a war was imminent. There is no alternative to having a strong professional military that is multi-skilled, well-trained, and well-motivated. Military actions, if any, in the Indian subcontinent is very carefully watched by the world, since there is an apprehension that it may escalate to nuclear dimensions. Large maneuvers and mobilization may be impractical. We need speed, precision, and firepower. Accordingly, India needs to strategize, equip, and train. The organization of our forces has undergone some changes since independence. We need to continually research, test, and evolve efficient packaging of forces, cost-effective weapon systems, quality training, and fast methods of deployment. For a military to be efficient, the man in uniform must view himself as a professional and not as a government servant. Unfortunately, democratic norms that impinge on a common citizen do influence the man in uniform. Many may view being an officer in the military as a government job that denotes permanency and minimal accountability. I am afraid that this will not work. For the military to be efficient, the man in uniform must see himself as a professional and an elitist. There is no free meal. Lots depend on how he sees himself on the mirror and how the service manages him. I stand here as the head of the Indian Air Force. I am accountable, and I am proud to state that we have a very competent Air Force. Thinking and experimenting are encouraged in the Indian Air Force. I am proud that I have some of the most brilliant minds and skills under my wings. We are second to none. We recently pitched our combat pilots on a training exercise with the American Air Force for the very first time. They brought their F-15s, which combated against our MiGs and Sukhois. It was a friendly boxing match. This is what the leader of the United States Air Force team had to say about Indian Air Force after exercising with us for 2 weeks. The Indian Air Force can stand toe-to-toe with any Air Force in the world. I pity the pilot who faces the Indian Air Force and chances the day to underestimate him because he won't be going home. Thank you. India needs to go proactive with regards to its national aspirations. National will is a multiplicative function and not additive. So is national morale. The feel-good factor needs to be converted to a sense of security for the state and the society. Our productivity must improve in all spheres. It is a challenge to our management and to our leadership. Revolution in peace and in war will relentlessly march forward with or without our participation. If we are not part of the roller, then we will be part of the road and we would be walked over. That, in my mind, should be motivation enough for us to drive the roller. Thank you very much. Jai Hind.
Let me start this afternoon first by thanking Mr. Arun Puri for inviting me to share my thoughts with you at this India Today Conclave, and for the honor and the privilege I have to express the ideas that I will present tonight. I'm going to speak on India's defense policy and the challenges that I perceive from the outside India's defense policy to face in the coming century. Let me start off, though, with a confession. I'm not a security fundamentalist. I'm not one of those who believes that war makes the state and that the state exists only to make war. I think states have multiple objectives, many more than are often accepted and given consideration. But when one looks at the broad sweep of history, especially the kind of history that Paul Kennedy walked us through, I think it becomes quite clear that countries cannot become great powers unless at some level they demonstrate mastery over the creation, deployment, and the use of military force in the service of national objectives. I am personally not convinced that Germany and Japan represent an alternative form of politics to the kind that the international system has seen for at least the last 2,000 years. In part because the exceptionalism of Germany and Japan was born out of the crucible of defeat and is really sheltered in an alliance relationship where others make allowances for their protection. For countries like India, which essentially seek to go their own way, I believe that the rise to great power status will at some level have to integrate the ability to create, deploy, and use military forces, and I use the term use in the broadest sense of the word, to achieve national objectives. Let me be clear about this. The ability to create and use military force for national purposes is not the only criterion for greatness, but it has to be a criterion that is integrated with other measures of greatness, like economic prowess, social cohesion, and political stability. Whether India can master military instruments of power, develop the tools that have made great powers for the last 2,000 years, in my view, will depend on its ability to master three macro problems and five micro problems. And let me briefly elaborate what those might be in turn. The first macro problem, which would be essential for India's rise as a great power and its ability to use military instruments creatively, will be its ability to sustain high rates of economic growth. In no other area has the aphorism, "It's the economy, stupid," been so appropriate as in the area of developing military strength. And the reason for that is very simple. Acquiring defense capabilities that are effective is expensive. A competent military costs money. And modern defense capabilities, which are sophisticated and effective, cost in numbers that boggle the imagination. I'll give you just two simple examples. The premier US frontline fighter today, the F-22, which is just on the cusp of entering service in the US Air Force, the United States' first stealth fighter, capable of air superiority and air dominance, costs $187 million apiece. An aircraft carrier of the kind that Paul Kennedy pictured for us in the slide in his briefing yesterday, in 1987, when evaluated by the best cost assessment methodology that actually exists, in 1987, dollars cost $3.8 billion for the ship and another $3 billion for the air wing. It should be no surprise that with unit costs of this magnitude, that the US defense budget is truly as stratospheric as it is. It's stratospheric for a reason, because capabilities which allow you to do the dramatic kinds of things that the Air Chief Marshal just referred to in his briefing are expensive. You may ask, what does such kind of sophistication and what does such kind of technology buy you at the end? I think it buys you at least three things. First, it buys you an ability to sharply reduce your casualties in the face of adversary action. Second, it buys you increased effectiveness even in the face of numerical inferiority. And third, it buys you the potential for quick victories which minimize political complications. When you factor these things, you recognize that at the end of the day, to make effective defense possible, you need good tools of the trade and good people who can use those tools. And those capabilities cost money. For a country like India, which has to deal not simply with questions of defense, but also questions of development simultaneously, where oftentimes India cannot choose between the objectives of defense and development, the question of high economic growth as the only solution that alleviates India's defense burdens really becomes non-negotiable. And when one begins to think of the revolution in military affairs, the kind of capabilities today that characterize the military forces of the great powers, it is simply impossible for India to embark anywhere in that direction without sustaining economic growth of at least 7 to 9% per annum consistently. China is a very good example. A country that has experienced close to double-digit growth for 20 years since 1978, still finds it hard to develop the kinds of military capabilities it seeks to across the board. And therefore, one must be prepared for the fact that even if the Indian economy were to grow between 7 and 9% consistently for the next 20 years, the best India will be able to do in the area of defense technology is only acquire niche capabilities. But those niche capabilities may be enough for the circumstances that it faces. The second macro problem that India needs to engage and satisfy is the development of an appropriate national vision and appropriate institutions. If you were to ask me what are India's political objectives in the post-Cold War period, I would argue that it is the continuing quest for security, for great power capabilities and status in support of expanded national autonomy. This is a formal definition. It's not clear, however, what the practical import of this definition is in practice. What substantive goals, defined in terms of national interest, does India really seek to service? And the answer to this cannot be defined in terms of platitudes like a just world order. That's a useful phrase for a political campaign. It's a terrible criterion for defense planning and force structuring. It's also not obvious whether India will develop the kind of state and national institutions that allow it to define its political goals clearly, that allow it to mobilize its resources, and finally, transform its resources efficiently into the kinds of instruments of power that the Air Chief Marshal highlighted a few minutes ago. The third aspect of this question of defining India's goals and institutions pertains to the issue of whether India will be able to achieve the right balance between state control and societal autonomy. It's very important to realize that successful states in the modern era have been those that have maintained this balance in the most creative way possible, where states have provided a certain modicum of direction, which has allowed them to sponge off the resources of a very productive and free society. Getting India to master this challenge is really going to make the difference between India's ability to become the great power that many in this country seek over the next decade or so to come. The third macro challenge that I would highlight for your consideration is whether India is capable of exploiting the existing structure of the international system to its advantage. In this connection, the first thought that I think India should productively get rid of is the notion of multipolarity. The notion of pursuing chimerical goals is not what makes for good policy. The international system, for all practical purposes, is going to remain a unipolar system for at least the next half century. And by any indicators, if you define power in terms of comprehensive national strength, it is unlikely that the United States will face serious peer competitors for at least another 50 years. In this context, the challenge for India then becomes, can New Delhi develop a viable strategic partnership with the United States that serves both mutual interests and India's own unilateral interests? Can India develop a relationship with the United States that helps it enhance and magnify its own power? This is not to suggest that the United States is the only power in the international system. Clearly not. There are many others. This is also not to suggest that India's goals consist solely, or India's is constrained solely, to develop a relationship with the United States and no other. Not true. India has the flexibility to maneuver within the interstices of the international system. But at the end of the day, there is one 800-pound gorilla that has to be engaged, and that is the United States. That gorilla is not going to go away. That gorilla has already put its nose for the first time in modern history in the environments of the subcontinent. And it is in India's national interest, and important for its capacity to generate and magnify its power, to develop a productive and a collaborative relationship with the United States that enhances the interests of the two countries. Besides these broad macro questions, which in some sense India will have to deal with in the decades ahead, I want to highlight for your consideration five micro problems that India has to master if it has to be able to make the gap into great power capabilities of the sort that Paul Kennedy identified. When I talk of these micro problems, I don't mean these problems are trivial. These are, in fact, the bread and butter issues that confront Indian security on a day-to-day basis. The first challenge that India has to deal with is the challenge of neutering internal security threats without undermining its capacity for effective external defense. This is harder to do than is sometimes imagined. It is unfortunate that the principal security threat that India is going to have to deal with on a day-to-day basis are threats to internal security. There's no running away from this problem. Historically, India dealt with this by essentially throwing manpower at the problem instead of technology. And the reason it did this was simply because it enjoyed a surfeit of manpower and a deficit of technology. There were two consequences to this strategy. One was that its strategy for maintaining internal defense was probably not as effective as it could be, because technology could provide a valuable supplement which was not available to India. The second consequence was that it has become extremely expensive and has come at the cost of being able to acquire new technologies. It is a myth that India's manpower is as cheap as it appears. Maintaining the kind of forces that India does, if maintained over the secular period, will undercut its ability to acquire the kinds of RMA capabilities that win modern wars. And this is going to require India to make very painful choices about reducing its manpower strength and changing the inter-service budgetary balances, choices that it cannot make today because of the gravity and the importance of the internal security commitment. The second micro issue that I want to draw your attention to is the need to preserve effective external defense now in a nuclear-shadowed environment. This brings us face to face with the vexed question of whether India has the capacity to prosecute successfully the issue of limited war. Most commentary so far has focused on the issue of limited war really as an example of Indian recklessness. People have chastised the Defense Minister, George Fernandes, for arguing that limited war, in fact, represents the solution to India's external security problems. I have a slightly different take on this problem. My view is that limited war should be viewed as a product not of the proclivities of a state, but rather as the predicament of a certain set of structural circumstances. And let me explain that. The presence of nuclear weapons in the subcontinent for the first time makes unlimited wars untenable as a matter of state policy. Ideally, they should also make war itself obsolete. Excuse me. But oftentimes, nuclear weapons don't do that. So we're confronted with a dilemma. On one hand, unlimited war is infeasible, but on the other hand, the obsolescence of war is not assured. And if one is confronted with this vice, then the only alternative one has, whether one likes it or not, is to think of how to manage and prosecute limited war successfully. This is not India's choice. This is the dilemma of the nuclear age. And it's a challenge that faces India both with respect to Pakistan and with respect to China. In both cases, unlimited war is infeasible. There is no guarantee that war is obsolete. And therefore, the challenge of limited war confronts India squarely, both with respect to its northern and its western borders. What does limited war mean for Indian defense policy? It means that India is now confronted with the task of being required to hit hard and effectively enough to punish an adversary, but not hit so hard or so effectively as to cause inadvertent escalation. This in turn leads to two problems. First, how do you avoid escalation? Most commentary has focused on this aspect of the problem. But there is a second aspect of the problem which has escaped attention. How do you prosecute and attain success in a limited war, so that the issue of escalation becomes relevant in the first place. If you're incapable of prosecuting a limited war, you don't have to worry about escalation. It's only in the context of being able to successfully prosecute it that the threat of escalation becomes real as a matter of public policy. And it is to this question that I would argue that India's policymakers and its defense establishment ought to give some attention, because it is going to demand of India a new style of war fighting that India traditionally has been uncomfortable with and traditionally been relatively incapable of. It's a style of war fighting that puts a premium on achieving very speedy decision on the battlefield, and then terminating offensive action either before the international community intervenes or before the conflict degenerates into unavoidable attrition. Getting the Indian military to prosecute a fast-paced war that generates quick decisions is something that we have not seen in 50 years of India's independence. It's also a kind of war that traditionally the United States felt very, very uncomfortable with. We liked the kind of wars which allowed us plenty of time to mobilize, plenty of time to deploy, and then plenty of time to be able to thrust the capabilities that we acquired at the adversary. This, in turn, is going to require of India four things. First, an investment in new technologies. Two, an investment in new doctrines. Three, an investment in new operating skills. And four, an investment in new concepts of operation. And don't forget the constraints. Acquiring these capabilities is going to be costly. They don't come on the cheap. Two, acquiring these capabilities is going to require changing certain political constraints. You cannot win limited wars successfully if you are hamstrung by the political constraint that you cannot lose a single inch of territory under any circumstances. And three, you are going to need a readiness to change the inter-service resource balance away from capabilities that are slow to capabilities that are flexible, precise, speedy, and lethal. Let me flag quickly the third micro problem that India needs to resolve, if it is to become a great power of the sort that it seeks to be. It has to be able to become a net provider of regional security both in the subcontinental and in the extra-subcontinental arenas. This is easier said than done. And yet, at one level, it is a quintessential part of the definition of a great power. What is the meaning of having great power capabilities if at the end of the day you cannot extend net security to others? And yet, any Indian attempt to provide the kind of regional security that I'm talking of, even in the subcontinental arena, is fraught with risk, because it risks deepening intra-regional rivalries, and it risks deepening the suspicions that India's weaker neighbors have of its capabilities and its intentions. There are further problems. If India decides to provide capabilities, to provide regional security support, who do you direct these capabilities towards? Do you direct them towards states, or do you direct them towards societies? It's not clear, it's not easy, and it's not obvious where India ought to direct its resources, especially in situations when state and societies are constantly at loggerheads. If one shifts the focus a bit and looks at the extra subcontinental arenas, you begin to realize that there are parallel sorts of dilemmas. The Air Chief Marshal very conveniently for me provided a map which defined for all of us in a very graphic sense what India's extended security environment is. What is not clear from the map, though, is what exactly India is prepared to do in practical terms to secure its interests in this extended security environment. Is India interested in peacekeeping? Is India interested in peacemaking? Is India interested in post-conflict stability operations? This spans a whole gamut of requirements. What does India really want to do? And if it made up its mind about what it wants to do, What frameworks is it willing to accept in order to do this? Is it willing to do this unilaterally? Is it willing to do this only through the UN? Or is it willing to do this through coalitions of the willing? Assuming it has managed to resolve the question of what it seeks to do and the frameworks under which it seeks to do it, it is still faced with a third set of questions. Does India have, and is it willing to acquire, the capabilities that are required by even the most minimal set of contingencies that one can imagine in this extended neighborhood? Even if one presumes that all India is going to do is engage in post-conflict stabilization operations, and it's going to do this in the most easy form possible, which is in the form of coalitions under UN flags, it requires India to make very expensive choices with respect to force modernization. It will require India to develop at least a small subset of formations that have world-class capabilities in terms of interoperability, or else India would be an ineffective member of the coalition. It would require India to develop capabilities that provide it with increased endurance and increased reach. Let me give you an example. You cannot be a serious claimant to providing extra regional security if you have a 100 ship navy with 2 underway replenishment vessels. You cannot be a serious aerospace power if your fighters are so short-legged that they cannot move from one rear base of operations to a forward facility abroad. Finally, will India develop the organizational structures required to maintain these capabilities if it seeks to provide the kind of regional security that I'm talking about? The fourth micro problem. Can India acquire effective nuclear deterrence without breaking the bank? My view is that nuclear weapons for India's security are important, but it's good to remember that they are actually relatively obsolescent as technologies. Nuclear weapons are 50 years old, and they are generally unusable as instruments of international politics. And therefore, while I can understand India's decision to acquire those weapons, I would make the argument that they are not worth the overinvestment. India's triad, its intellectual triad, of minimum deterrence, no first use, and strict civilian control, in my judgment, provide the recipe for allowing it to develop a nuclear deterrence without moving in the direction of bankruptcy. On one condition, it must successfully resist the temptation over the long term in a way that we did not in the United States, a task that we failed in 50 years of the Cold War. It must resist the temptation to discover new, exotic, operational uses for its nuclear weaponry. The United States, through a very painful experience, discovered operational uses of nuclear weaponry, which resulted in a nuclear force of about 50 weapons in the early 1950s, becoming a nuclear force of about 50,000 nuclear weapons in the early 1990s. The last micro problem, and I'll deal with this very briefly, is the question of India's developing an appropriate defense industrial policy that recognizes and accepts the limits to autarky. I recognize that India's traditional fear of vulnerability have driven its traditional strategy of large-scale defense import substitution. I think the time has come, though, that India must resist the temptation of trying to develop everything from assault rifles to main battle tanks to advanced combat aircraft. If you look at the record of India in this regard, successes have been relatively far and few. There are things that can be done. They require better institutional arrangements for coordination, better institutional arrangements for technical audit and hard-nosed review. But even when these are successful, there is a simple economic fact of life that cannot be lost sight of. India's armed forces are relatively small, and the economies of scale that they generate in terms of demand often do not warrant India undertaking the efforts to begin end-to-end production, especially of expensive capabilities. Where does all this take us in terms of our judgments about India's capacity to develop the defense capabilities that would make it a great power in this century. My argument essentially would be that its capacity to master the creation, deployment, and use of military instruments is at this point in time still not assured. Whether it will succeed in this endeavor will really depend greatly on how it resolves the micro and the macro problems that I identified. Sunil Kalnani, in his presentation, used a marvelous phrase. He argued that India still lacks an instinct for power. I tend to believe that at one level, this may be the root cause of its inability to acquire the kinds of capabilities that we've been talking about. India still remains, in my judgment, a deeply conservative, relatively inward-looking state that has focused more on satisficing rather than maximizing. At one level, that is probably what is most attractive about India. Its innate capacity for moderation in terms of its grand strategy and the use of force. But that also implies that as far as military instruments go, India might be condemned, at least for some time to come, might be condemned to remaining a middle power as opposed to a great power in the Kennedy-esque sense of the term. And if that is in fact true, then we must admit that the kinds of bridging strategies that Sunil Kalnani advocated may turn out to be far more important than even the most passionate voices advocating a strong Indian military capability are compelled to admit today. Thank you very much.